So this is how the Yogacharya school interprets the meaning of the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras. In contrast, the Madhyamaka school, the middle way school, develops a different reading of the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras, where they would read the Perfection of Wisdom scriptures as being literal and accept the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras statement that all things and events are devoid of any intrinsic identity and intrinsic existence. So they do not make distinctions between subject, the consciousness or the mind, and the object, the matter, and the objective world of external reality. For example, one of the texts belonging to the Perfection of Wisdom class is the 100,000 verses on Perfection of Wisdom, in which we read explicit the qualifying term that things and event do not exist in the ultimate sense or on the ultimate level. So this qualifying expression, on the ultimate level or ultimately, is explicitly found in the Perfection of Wisdom Sutra itself. Therefore, the Madhyamaka school maintained that the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras are literal, and by their statement that all things and events do not possess any intrinsic reality, does not imply that nothing exists, that all things and events are non-existent. This is not the meaning of these scriptures. And and furthermore, they argue that the Mind Only School's reading of the Perfection of Wisdom Sutra is flawed because they make unnecessary discrimination between the nature of reality of the external world and also the nature of reality of the internal consciousness or mind. And although as a result of reflecting upon their understanding of the rejection of the objective reality of the material world, one can reduce the force of strong attachment and aversion to the external objects. But given that they do not extend the same argument to the internal world of experience and consciousness, and they have simply no effective method of addressing and overcoming attachments that are directed towards the internal world of experience, such as experience of joy, unhappiness, sadness, and so pleasure, and so on. And within the Madhyamaka school, there are, of course, some who go to some extent with the Chittamatra school's understanding of the absence of the reality of the external world, but they feel that the same argument should be applied to the world of internal experience as well. These are known as the Yogacara Madhyamaka school. However, other Madhyamaka school, they feel that discriminate between the, insofar as understanding the ultimate nature of reality is concerned, there's making a discrimination between the nature of the external world and the internal world of experience and consciousness is unhelpful. One must, across the entire spectrum of reality, one must negate intrinsic existence equally and categorically. And so they argue that one of the underlying premises for the mind-only school's rejection of the objective reality of the external world is their belief that the notion of the objective reality of the external world presupposes a notion of indivisible atom or indivisible particles, which must be the ultimate constitutive elemental kind of matter, which then acts as a basis and then can explain the reality of the objective world. And since they argue that the concept of this indivisible atom is untenable, therefore one must also reject the objective reality of the material world. So the Madhyamakas argue that one can use the same argument to negate the substantial reality of the external world of internal world of experience as well, because in order to maintain the substantial reality of consciousness or mind, one must also presuppose the possibility of believing in some kind of indivisible moment of consciousness, a moment of cognition. However, cognition and consciousness and subject can only be made sense in terms of a continuum of cognition, in terms of a process. And therefore, given that it is only on the basis of a process or a continuum that one can conceive, have the concept of cognition or consciousness, therefore even the internal world of consciousness and cognition is also devoid of substantial reality. And furthermore, by extending this reasoning across categorically, both across the world of external world of matter and internal world of consciousness and cognition, the Madhyamakas argue that one will be able to undermine the basis for the arisals of attachment, both to the external world and at the same time to the internal world of experience as well. So when you reflect upon this Madhyamaka idea of how all things and events, all phenomena are devoid of a substantial existence, substantial reality, then this idea will have an impact upon your sort of emotional sort of engagement with the objects, thus will decrease the force of your attachment or aversion to the world. So, among the Madhyamaka masters, the founding master of Madhyamaka school is of course Nagarjuna, and Nagarjuna had many disciples, prominent disciples, students such as Aryadeva, Puttapalita, Ashvaghosh, Bhavaviveka, Chandrakirti, Mathankiva, and Nagabhuti, Shakyamitra, and so on. And amongst these, those who wrote, reading of Nagarjuna's Fundamentals of the Middle Way, which became highly influential, were such as Puttapalita, Bhavaviveka, and Chandrakirti. Puttapalita wrote a highly authoritative commentary on the Nagarjuna's Fundamentals of the Middle Way, and his commentary carried the same name of the author. It was called Puttapalita. And later, Bhavaviveka wrote another commentary of Nagarjuna's Fundamentals of the Middle Way called The Lamp of Wisdom, in which he then critically examined some aspects of Puttapalita's reading of Nagarjuna and criticized them, which were then defended. Puttapalita's commentary was criticized by Bhavaviveka. And later, in defense of Puttapalita's reading, Chandrakirti wrote an influential commentary called Prasanapada, the Clear Words, which is a commentary on the Fundamentals of the Middle Way, in which Chandrakirti defended the Prasangika's reading. And if you, when you read Chandrakirti's Prasanapada very closely and carefully, we will then begin to see that there is actually a fundamental a philosophical difference between the interpretation of Nagarjuna's thought by Puttapalita on the one hand and Bhavaviveka on the other. And one of the principal points of difference between these two readings were whether or not one accepts the notion of commonly appearing objects, and whether or not it is possible for two parties in a dispute to have a kind of a shared perception of the object under investigation, the perceptions of valid cognitions of which are both valid in the equally in the equal understanding. And this was rejected by Chandrakirti, and this was accepted by Bhava Viveka. And so when you read carefully Bhava Viveka's own commentary and also in relation to Chandrakirti's critique of it, one thing that becomes very clear is that there is a fundamental philosophical difference in the two standpoints. It seems that the Bhava Viveka, although accepting Nagarjuna's teaching on emptiness, yet accepts that a degree of intrinsicality can be accorded to things and events. For example, Bhava Viveka seems to maintain that although person or the self is a mental construct contingent upon the physical and mental aggregates of an individual, but at the same time, in the final analysis, if one were to search for the true referent of the term person or the self, one should be able to find something that is has some kind of substantial reality. For example, in Bhava Viveka's own writing, he identifies, he singles out mental consciousness as being the true person that can be found in the final analysis. So what comes through this is the difference, the distinction that Bhava Viveka's school accepts some notion of intrinsic existence, some degree of objectivity and some notion of intrinsicality to things and events, whereas Chandrakirti and the Buddha Palita's school rejects even the notion of intrinsicality even on the conventional level. So from this we see that amongst Nagarjuna's disciples or commentators, there are two principal camps, which then came to be known as the Svatrantika school of Madhyamaka and Prasangika Madhyamaka school. And given that there is a fundamental philosophical difference between these two camps, it is also reflected in the methodology these two school followers of these two schools use, apply in establishing their understanding of emptiness. For example, just as it is the case in Nagarjuna's own fundamentals of the middle way, in Chandrakirti and Buddha Palita's writings, the most dominant form of argumentation that is used is not syllogism, but rather what is known as the consequentialist reasoning, which operates like a reductio absurdum, showing internal inconsistencies between the opponent's views, whereas in the writings of Bhava Viveka and his followers, a more dominant approach is to present a syllogistic style of argument. So we see that not only is there a difference in the philosophical standpoints, but also this difference is reflected in the methodology that is preferred by the two camps. So, and therefore these two schools came to be known as the Svatrantika school, which means autonomous school, because they accept autonomous syllogism or autonomous reasoning, and Prasangika school, which means the consequentialist school, because they prefer the consequentialist style of argumentation. And so Bhava Viveka's school is then later upheld by such masters as Dhyanagarbha and so on, whereas the Buddha Palita school is upheld by masters such as Buddha Palita himself, Chandrakirti and Shantideva and so on. The fact that Buddha Palita does not accept the concept of intrinsic reality or intrinsic nature, even on the conventional level, is very evident by reading his own commentary. For example, when commenting on the passage in Madhyamaka Avata, Madhyamaka Mula Karika, Mula Madhyamaka Karika, the fundamentals of the middle way of Nagarjuna, which negates the fourfold modes of coming into being, such as the self-production and production from the other and so on, there Buddhapalita makes an observation that if we subject the notion of origination to a critical analysis, then the concept of origination becomes untenable. Yet, since things do come into being as a result of causes and conditions, since things do have origination, and therefore we can only understand the notion of origination or coming into being on the conventional level. So this is very explicitly stated in Buddhapalita's commentary on that passage. And also in Buddhapalita's text, somewhere we read it, I don't remember the exact chapter where this passage is found, but there Buddhapalita writes that if things and events exist by means of objective, intrinsic nature, then it is sufficient to simply accept that as their, you know, as their being. Why is it then necessary to posit their identity and existence in relation to other things? There is no need for dependence. And the fact that things and events can only be understood in relation to or in dependence upon other factors suggests that they are devoid of, they do not exist by means of some kind of intrinsic objective reality. And also, it is evident from Bhava Viveka's writing that amongst the four modes of origination, he does accept, at least on the conventional level, the origination of things from other causes which are distinct from themselves. And also, if you look at Chantakirti's writings, he explicitly states, for example, in the Madhyamaka Avatara, supplement to the middle way, fundamentals of middle way, where he writes that not only such as the person do not exist if you subject through critical analysis in the ultimate, on the ultimate level, even in, on the conventional level, if you subject the notion of person to the sevenfold analysis, it is not findable. So this indicates that so far as the notion of intrinsic nature is concerned, or intrinsic existence is concerned, Chantakirti rejects this even on the conventional level as well. So if you look at Bhava Viveka and such as his followers, Shantarakshitas and so on, their understanding of the qualifying term, the things and events do not exist on the ultimate level, how do they understand this notion of ultimacy? It is also quite clear that they understand the ultimacy in relation to the wisdom analyzing the ultimate nature of reality. In contrast, in Chantakirti's Madhyamaka Avatara, supplement to the middle way, Chantakirti explicitly states that not only the subject, the person who is the subject of experience or the agent that undergoes the experience of pain and pleasure and so on, and also his objects of experience, all of these, when you subject them to critical analysis by means of the sevenfold reasoning, then none of them are tenable, none of them can be found. And what this indicates is that all things and events, including one's own self, it is very clear that they are all devoid of any intrinsic nature or intrinsic reality. And also this suggests that none of them exist by means of some kind of objective reality, some kind of a status which they possess in their own accord. Yet, this does not imply that they do not exist at all. They do exist. And the question is, in what sense can we say they exist? In what sense they do exist? And then Chandrakirti responds to this by saying that we can understand their existential status, their existence, only by means of the power of convention, the power of conventional reality. And therefore, this notion of this concept of some kind of objective existence in their own accord, things and events possessing some kind of existence in their own accord, is a false understanding, and the negation of that constitutes the final understanding of emptiness.
当然了。